there are inherent flaws that are there in my process, right? So I was facing time constraints. So if you don't have the process engraved, you'll automatically start facing the time constraints, right? That is when I reached out to you that I'm not able to complete my verbal section in time. What is that you suggest?
Welcome, Rashish, to another 740 debriefing session. Congratulations on scoring a perfect Q51 and a V39. How do you feel?
Thanks, DJ. Thanks a lot. So first things first, I would like to thank you for supporting me throughout the preparation. So getting to this 740 mark wouldn't have been possible without your inputs that I got. And also, I would like to take a moment and thank the e-GMAT support team, right? So I actually came up with all kind of requests. And they always gave a positive feedback and in a very prompt time also. So it did not take a lot of time. Coming to your question. So initially I planned that I'll give my GMAT after preparing for 2 months, right?
Yeah.
But eventually it turned out to be a 6 months long preparation. So seeing that 750 score, I really felt relieved that, okay, I was done with the first part of the application and now I can move towards the other part of the application. So relieved is the word that I'll say.
Got
after
it.
Getting that
7.0. And like you said, it's been a long journey, right? So you first, I think you scored a 710 where you briefly engaged with me during LMT. And then of course at 710 to that 740. But so let's start off with your journey before that 710. What did you do before that? What did you do after coming to e-GMAT?
Sure. So I started off my preparation in somewhere around May 2021, right? And back then I thought that, okay, if I solve a lot of questions, because I've already prepared for one of the MB exams that you need to take in India. So for the quants part, it was more or less sorted. RC was more or less sorted. It was only SC and CR that I needed to focus on.
Yeah.
So like most students, I started off with OGs. And that, according to me, was the first mistake that I made during my first preparation. Reason being, OGs are a great source for, let's say, great question bank.
Yeah.
But if you're looking to engrave a process or if you're looking to develop a process, it's not that great a source, right? And that is what I saw when I started giving mocks also, that I was doing fine with the RC and the quants part because I already had that process engraved.
Yeah.
But as far as the CR and the HC part was concerned, since I did not have a process, if there was no process, inherent process, I was making those mistakes, right? So till July, mid-July, I was solving OG questions. And so the problem with OG quants is that the difficulty level is very low as compared to what you get in the actual examination. Even in the mocks, right? You can clearly see there's a demarcation between the difficulty level. So I switched from OGs to GMAT club. I used to solve really difficult questions as far as the quants was concerned. So this was mid-July, right?
Yeah.
Till then, I was scoring around 710, 720s in my official mocks. And I think I gave an e-GMAT mock also. And that I scored low. I scored around 650. So that is when I realized that there was a flaw in the way that I was solving the SC questions.
Yeah.
Right? I was looking at the grammar. I was focusing a lot on the grammar, which is not the right step to do. Then I came across the e-GMAT meaning-based webinar. And that truly changed the way I actually solved the SC questions. Then I started focusing a lot on the meaning. But then again, right, the problem with the meaning-based approach is that you need to know how to extract the meaning. That is the first step in getting the meaning-based approach right.
Yeah.
So I realized that there was a flaw in the way I was extracting the meaning. And that is when I decided that, okay, I've already breached my timeline of 2 months, so might as well give another month. So I enrolled for the e-GMAT course. And I specifically focused on the SC part of it.
Yeah.
The problem again was that I only gave around a month, right? So, and in order to, so the SC course is really extensive as if in the e-GMAT. So it's very, very fragmented. There's layers to it, right? Yeah. And if you give around a month and with, so I had my job also, right? And I used to work for 5 days and 8 to 10 hours is normal for me, right? So I had that constraint also. So I don't think that I gave my best as far as the course was concerned. I focused more on solving questions, but solving questions does not engrave that process. And so by the end of it, I think it was because of the problems that I faced in the SC and the CR that I got a 710. The split there was a Q49 and a V39. 35 out of 36.
Yeah.
And I think it was majorly driven by SCNC.
So I think, you know, I think that's when you reached out to me when you were just about 7 or 10 days from your exam, and you said, listen, I kind of need some help. And we did those little right things in the right direction to, of course, score a 700 plus. There's a foolproof formula for that. But of course, those elemental things about SCNCR, of course, don't change. So talk about how we figured out actually it was SCNCR, because even doing that was a challenge in itself.
So DJ, the last 7 or 8 days, right? So I had sent the e-GMAT team a mail that I was facing. I was facing time constraints. So if you don't have the process engraved, you'll automatically start facing the time constraints, right? And that is when I reached out to you that I'm not able to complete my verbal section in time. What is that you suggest? And you said that we'll take those stress tests, right?
Yeah.
So in that, let's say if we are given 65 minutes in the actual exam, we are going to do those questions in 60 or 62 odd minutes. And so I started giving those, and it became very evident that as soon as you start facing that stress or you start having that stress, right, the inherent problems start to aggravate.
Yeah.
Right. So I started seeing that my SC accuracy started falling, and I even sent you a mail, right?
Yeah.
That I'm doing fine as far as the time is concerned, but my SC accuracy has taken
true.
A toll.
Yeah.
It happens, right? If you're given that stressful situation, automatically your problem starts to aggravate. And that is what happened. And it was then that I realized, okay, that I haven't done justice to the SC modules that were there. But however, I had already booked my slot. So I said I might as well give the exam and then I'll do what is required.
Right. So I think after you gave the exam, you got a Q49. I think it was a V36 or 35. And we connected again to kind of figure out, okay, listen, what happened? And of course, we knew what the issue was inherently.
Right.
And that's when I think I gave you a vision of, okay, this is how you're going to go about fixing it. And then I think you took it from there and said, listen, I have to get back to work as well. There are a few things that have come up. And then you took your prep up from there on out. So tell me what you did throughout that period of time to kind of stay in touch with your studies and working towards that goal of a better score.
So the call that we had, DJ, during that call, I had this strange deadline in my mind that, again, I need to spend another month or so and get the exam done with. But it was later, around 2 to 3 days after that, I realized that there are inherent flaws that are there in my process, right? And it is not something that can get solved in a month. And as such, I did not have a fixed deadline as far as the application was concerned. So why rush through?
Yeah.
It was then that I decided, okay, I'm going to retake the SC course. And at the same time, since so in my 7-10 attempt, I started seeing that the CR questions, I was perfectly okay with medium level difficulty questions. But as soon as the questions got tougher, I started seeing a dip in my accuracy.
Yeah.
And that is something that even you pointed out, right? During the call that we had. So I thought, okay, let me just go through the entire SC and the CR modules. And then I'll move towards, let's say, solving questions. So I spent around a month or so, or more, even more, I think 1.5 months or so, right?
Yeah.
Just solving and understanding what the process should be like. And it really helped me, right? Because in the second attempt, I solved fewer questions as compared to my first attempt, but I got a higher score. So that was because I had that process engraved already.
And let's talk about that process, right? That's very, very important, because I think I have probably written you 3 emails. One email was the RC and SC ability improvement package. The other one was the last mile plan, which is basically a very, very structured approach of how to go into your last 10 days of prep only when you're ready for it. And I think one was the, you know, the last minute tips and stuff like that. Let's talk about the, you know, the SC and RC ability package. What did you take away from that package and how that helped you kind of improve on SC and RC and CR as well?
So the first part of it, right, the one that you're talking about, the SC, was related to the master comprehension course that is there.
Yeah.
So again, I skipped, because of some reason, I skipped through the master comprehension course, even after giving that much of time to the course. And so again, let me just take a step back. So I solved a lot of SC questions, right? I solved a lot of questions. And as you suggested, that I should invest a lot of time on the strategic review, which I rightly did. I filled in my error log very thoroughly. I looked at the problems that I was facing. And inherently, in most of the questions that I was getting wrong, I was not able to extract the meaning, one, or I was not able to extract the meaning in the time that I should, right? The meaning extraction part was the issue. And you rightly pointed out that in order to get that thing sorted, you should look at the master comprehension course. And that, according to me, was a pivotal role as far as the SC preparation is concerned, right? Because, yes, the meaning-based approach is important, but you need to know how do you actually extract the meaning. For that, those pause points, those fragmenting the statement into different aspects, the subject, verb, and the object, all that becomes really important. So my SC accuracy really improved after taking the master comprehension course because I was able to extract the meaning, one, more accurately, and two, quickly also. So even my time that I actually took in solving SC questions reduced drastically.
I think that's totally the idea of actually sharing that. And a lot of people tell me this, that, you know, we've gone through the SC course once, twice, and thrice. And every time we go through it, there's something new that I would, of course, learn about it. And that's absolutely true. It's very layered, right? So the first time you go through it, you don't really understand the importance of half of the things there, unless you did like really do it well. Now let's move on to the last mile plan. What was that plan about? How did that help and work for you?
So as far as the last, this is what I remember of it. So there were three parts to it, right? One was solving the mocks. Then the second part of it was increasing the speed in which you actually solve the question.
Speed test,
That again, the stress testing, the speed test come into practice. And then since I was facing problem with the SC and CR part, there were specific, what do I call it? Specific set of questions. So you gave me that, okay, you need to solve five
targeted practice
SC and five questions. Exactly. And again, the time was lower in those questions. So the mocks, yes, I was solving the mocks on regular intervals. So I gave all the e-GMAT mocks. And this time onwards, I wasn't facing the issues that I was facing in the first time. The timing part of it was taken care of. Because one, my the time that I took to solve CR questions improved drastically. The reason was that earlier I did not use to fragment the statement into different aspects. Now I started to fragment it. So it became easier to solve the CR questions. So again, the mock helped me in figuring out, okay, my strategy as far as the solving the paper is concerned, it's going fine. As far as the increase in speed is concerned, the stress test and the CR and SC specific tests also played a major role. So, and this actually helped me during the examination because I'd already trained my mind to be in that stressful situation. So during my examination, I was able to solve both my verbal and the quant section before time. So in verbal, I had around 5 minutes left and quants, I had around 10 minutes left. So the stress testing actually really helped. So even for quants, you gave me the stress test similar. There was fixed number of questions and a lower amount of time. So again, that stressful situation was already something that my mind was trained to.
And let's talk a little bit about this. And of course, you're not touched upon it, but the fact that you got a Q51, right? Like, I'm sure a lot of people would want that score. Talk to what you did to get this Q51. What are the things that helped and, you know, throughout your prep?
So, Dhananjay, like I mentioned, right, I started off with the OG. OG wasn't a great source. So I switched to different sources on the GMAT club. The problem with the GMAT club is the questions are very fragmented, right? You'll get a question which is really difficult, and then you'll get a question that is really easy. So the types of questions that you get is not that great. The question bank isn't that great. This actually got solved when I started using Scholaranium, the quant Scholaranium especially, right? So what I used to do was I used to make these question banks of around 30 questions, which had 5 questions from each of the
topics,
the buckets that are there. And then I used to give those tests. So, and I used to keep the medium and hard difficult questions only, right? So the difficulty level of the quants, as far as the e-GMAT is concerned, it's definitely slightly higher than the actual exam. But according to me, it is actually really helpful, right? Because you've already trained your mind to solve those difficult questions. So even the most difficult questions in the examination don't seem to take you off guard.
Exactly.
So in the first attempt that I gave, right? So I gave the online version of it. The online version, according to me, and this is simply my perspective on it, it's slightly more higher than the one that you give in the center, right? So the level of difficulty of the question actually took me off guard. And it was because of that that I got a 49, right? Because I did not expect that the difficulty to be that high.
And I remember you were super sad about it. You're like, 49, exactly. How did that happen?
Exactly. So I was scoring 51s in all of the official mocks that I gave. Even in the first mock I gave, I got a 50, right? So 49 was a shocker to me. And I think I told you that I'm aiming for a 51, and you said that 51 is going to be a difficult
task. Yeah, it is.
Yeah, but eventually it all fell in place. But yeah, again, coming back to the point, the main point is that the difficult question, the more the difficult question that you solve, the more easier it gets for you in the actual examination, right? So it really proved to be.
And how was your experience in quant on the exam? You know, just take me through that also.
Exactly. This is something that is not spoken about much. And so this is a pattern that I have seen even in the official mocks. And this is something that I saw in the real exam that I gave or the actual exam that I gave. So if you are on track to get a 51 score, right? So the first 10 questions, you'll see an increasing difficulty level. As soon as you reach the 10-12th mark, the 10-12 difficult 10-12th question mark, you'll see that the difficulty level has reached the peak, and then it is going to remain the same till the 20 or 21st question, right? So the 10-12 questions that you get in the middle are actually the hardest. It's not the case that you get the most difficult question towards the end. Towards the end, the level of difficulty actually reduces. So it is really important to have that in mind if you're targeting a 50 or a 51, because the most difficult questions you get going to get in the middle. So you can spend more time on those questions and not worry about the question that you're going to get at the end, because you'll be able to solve the questions very quickly.
Got it. I think that's very true as well, because when I gave the test, that's precisely what happened. I kind of found the questions in between very, very hard. And I was like, listen, I've really messed up because these questions are super hard. And in the end, I got two or three super easy questions, like X plus Y is equal to 7 and, you know, stuff like that. Exactly. And I was like, wow, I must have really messed up. But you're absolutely spot on about that. That was my experience when I scored a Q51 too. So now that you have scored a 740, of course, I think it's been a long journey from, you know, 650, 710, 740. What are these really important gems and learnings that you take away from your journey that can help someone else to kind of, you know, get this score?
So before starting off with this session that we had, I had three things in my mind that I simply wanted to put in front, right? So if there's someone who's watching the videos, these three are the most important points that actually helped me in my journey. First, for the SC course, go through the Master Comprehension course, right? Once you are able to extract the meaning completely, the way that you solve a question and the time that you take to solve a question will reduce drastically. Second would be the CR part. So CR, yes, the pre-thinking part is very important, but to get that pre-thinking right, you need to fragment the argument that you have, right? You need to fragment the argument between, let's say, okay, this is the premise, this is the conclusion.
You visualize it. Conclusion. Yeah.
Exactly. And that really is a very important step that actually turned out to be a game changer as far as the CR was concerned for me. So fragment the information, understand that this is the conclusion, okay? And this is the only point that I need to strengthen, weaken, or whatever the question asks you to do. The third part is have a strategy to solve the different sections and have the strategy beforehand, right? And practice this on your mocks. So for verbal strategy that I used, I basically divided the complete examination into 6 blocks. The first block was of 10 minutes, the rest of the blocks were for 11 minutes. And in each of the blocks, I made it a point that I had to solve 6 questions. And let's say in third block, I wasn't able to solve 6 questions. I was only able to solve 5 questions. In next block, I made it a point to just skip one of the questions so that I wasn't leaving out a lot of questions towards the end. And same for quants, right? Like I mentioned that towards in between that you get very difficult questions if you are scoring really high on quants. So factor that in, have that strategy in mind, okay, that I'm going to get those questions. I'm going to spend extra time on that. So have that fixed strategy for tackling both of the sections separately. So those would be my three main takeaways from the preparation.
Well, I think very valuable. Yeah, I think this time strategy thing, so many people have different approaches to kind of doing this, but this is a very new and interesting one. In fact, it's really good that people will hear and kind of see this maybe implemented as well. Once again, thank you so much for doing the session, and I'm supremely happy to have worked with you.
Thanks, DJ. The experience has been great, and thanks a lot for all your help. Thanks a lot.
Pleasure. Bye.